Don't identify with the mind. Identify the mind. In other words, we're not our thoughts. We're not our desires. Those are things that the mind is generating. We're actually a spiritual being utilizing the mind. And so one of the most powerful practices is the ability to observe your own mind. I think we all have our journeys, and there's a famous aphorism which says you have to live life going forwards, but you can only sometimes understand it looking backwards. And so I think the first memories I have, or the first important aspects which brought me to where I am now, actually, according to our ancient philosophy, begin in previous lives. They say that we enter this life with what we call samskaras, or impressions. So each of us, when we enter this world, we have certain personalities, certain qualities, certain inclinations. And for me, simplicity, minimalism, and solitude, these were all very natural qualities for me as a child. And so that was kind of the first piece of the puzzle when I look at my life now, of where becoming a monk had its roots. Mm-hmm. So there was that. And then when I was 15 or 16, I began to be very inquisitive about life. I grew up in Wembley, in a cosmopolitan city, surrounded by different cultures and religions. It was a melting pot of different traditions. And so naturally I became inquisitive, and I think that upbringing and that environment was also another piece of the puzzle. And then of course meeting spiritual people and learning spiritual wisdom from them, that completely shifted my vision of life. It changed my definition of success. And then obviously taking some time out after university and exploring the sacred land of India, where I traveled for 6 months, that was also a big turning point in my life. So I think an amalgamation of all of these things through my life probably brought me to where I am now, trying to live as a renounced monk. I don't know if there was one specific moment, but I think my time at university was paradigm shifting. I was living in London, I was studying at UCL, it was the first time I was away from home, and university life meant new experiences, late nights, and new friend circles. And what I basically did at university is I was juxtaposing two lives. I was becoming spiritually inclined, and so I was exploring that. And I was also living at university in an independent way for the first time, and exploring what you would say material life had to offer. And when I juxtaposed those two approaches to life, the material and the spiritual, juxtaposed those approaches to happiness, then I began to think one was progressive and the other one was quite limited and superficial. And so it was really a time when I began to build a vision of life in which I knew spirituality would become very central to whatever I would do in the future. And I think that was probably the main turning point. Our days are, in one sense, very similar and also very, very different as well. Every day we wake up in the morning at the same time, and we have the same morning routine where we meditate, we study. The day begins at 4 o'clock in the morning before the sun has risen, and we use those times for meditation, reflection, introspection. Another major part of living in a monastery is we all do humble services, services which ground you, menial things. We wash floors, we clean toilets, we cut vegetables. And that's very nice. There's a certain simplicity of that which very much grounds you into a mindset of humility and non-vanity. So service is another aspect of our life. Another aspect of our life is sharing wisdom, teaching, counseling, coaching. We work with people, not just that, we work with schools, universities, corporate organizations, and we try to share wisdom in a relevant and innovative and practical way. And we try to show how a lot of the problems that people face in their life can be solved through deepening their spirituality. So that's another part of our life. And in the evenings, we tend to slow down and unwind. But not just unwind, we tend to use that time to reflect on everything that's happened in the day and digest all the events and experiences so that we can become wiser and more equipped to continue on the next day doing what we do, which is trying to basically bring spirituality into the world. It depends. Different days are different. Oftentimes when we go to meet people who are living and working in the world, then the evenings are the only times they have free. So sometimes we go and visit them. It could end up a late night. So sometimes our sleep is curtailed in the night time, but then we catch up. But as far as possible, we try to keep a regulation whereby we sleep by 9 p.m., 10 p.m. and try to rise by 4. So we get 6 or 7 hours in. Yeah, modern science says actually that 6 or 7 hours, of course everybody's body is different, so it varies, but on average that's a good amount to sleep. And modern science also says that the hours that you sleep before midnight are actually worth more. And so it's not just about sleeping a certain amount of hours, but it's about sleeping in a certain time period as well. The first thing I would say is we need to take stock of what we're doing in our lives. We tend to waste a lot of time. We tend to invest a lot of time in things which won't actually help us to fulfill our goals. We tend to spend too long doing certain things, or we spend too short doing other things, which mean we end up spending more time later on to correct the mistakes. So it always helps for someone to take stock of their life and ask themselves, how am I using my time? And what am I investing my time in? Because when we use our time wisely, but not just that, we invest doing it in the right activities, then we actually find that 24 hours in a day is actually a big amount of time, and you can actually get a lot done. But we tend to not be able to maximize it because of these reasons. So I would say, look at whether you're wasting any time, look at the activities you're spending time in, and whether they're actually going to really bring you the things you want in your life, and which activities are you spending too much time in, and which activities are you spending too less time in. And when we do this kind of analysis, because time is the most valuable thing we have in the world, they say, once you lose a moment of time, even if you have millions of gold coins, you can't buy it back. So yeah, using time wisely is a hugely important life skill. Physical health, monks live quite active lives. We do yoga every single morning, and we do those exercises which have a physical benefit, which have a mental benefit, and which also prepare us and make us more ready for our spiritual practices as well. So we do some of that. Of course, as monks, we engage in bhakti yoga, in which there's singing and dancing and a lot of movement. So like that, we get a lot of good physical exercise. Throughout the day, we're moving, we're meeting people, and we're active. So a monk's life is an active life, and yeah, we try to keep regulation. This is a really important part of maintaining physical health. One of the biggest problems in the world today is that people don't eat at the same times. They don't sleep at the same times. They don't do activities at regular intervals, like, for example, drinking water. And therefore, just by simply regulating your life and ensuring you're doing certain crucial things at the same time every day, lifestyle helps to battle illnesses before they appear. Uh, 80%. Yeah, different monks approach it in different ways, but my general approach is I'm a fruits person in the morning. I have a light morning meal. Breakfast is actually a really important meal of the day because, you know, the toxins and other things, it's important to move the digestive system. But I tend to go light and I have fruit, smoothie, something like that. And then I have a more, a bigger lunch. That tends to be my main meal of the day. And in the evening time, something simple, milk and maybe a small snack or something like that. And that tends to be sufficient. They say you should eat to live and not live to eat. So we try to regulate our intake according to what is required. This is actually the same question that Arjuna asked Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita. The Bhagavad Gita, as we know, is one of the most important and central texts to Eastern spiritual wisdom. And when Krishna is faced with that question by Arjuna, then Krishna replies by saying that the mind is definitely very difficult to control. The mind can be the greatest friend or the greatest enemy. And what Krishna says is that you have to learn two things if you want to control the mind. In Sanskrit, the first thing is abhyas, which means practice or spiritual discipline. And the second thing Krishna says is vairagya, which means detachment. So what Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita is that the first thing in controlling or dealing with the mind, which is always flickering, is that don't identify with the mind. Identify the mind. In other words, we're not our thoughts, we're not our desires. Those are things that the mind is generating. We're actually a spiritual being utilizing the mind. And so one of the most powerful practices is the ability to observe your own mind instead of thinking you are the mind. And in that way, you don't identify with negativity, you don't identify with unhelpful mindsets or desires that will draw you away from where you're trying to go. So that's the first thing, that we learn to separate ourselves from the mind and observe it rather than identifying with it. But the second thing we do is we do spiritual practice, so meditation, times of stillness, times of solitude and quiet, time when we just give the mind space to relax and detach from the world. And so we do that early in the mornings, in the evenings we introspect. And most people in this world, they don't give their mind any breathing space, and they don't do anything to train the mind or service the mind. So we encourage people to do meditation and to spend time in stillness and solitude. And this also helps to deal with some of the difficulties we have with the mind. If you try to drive from the suburbs of London into central London at 4 o'clock in the morning, you'll get straight through. But if you try to make the same journey at 9 or 10 o'clock in the morning, you'll double your journey time because there's traffic, there's roadworks, there's all kinds of unpredictability of what could be happening in the world. Meditation is the same. if you do it in the early morning when things are much more clear, the atmosphere is clear, the mind is more clear, there's less disturbance, and the atmosphere in general is more conducive to divine connection, then you'll have a much more fruitful experience. If you try to meditate at 9, 10 o'clock in the morning when the world's moving, when the messages are flying in, and when everyone's running around chasing different things, it's going to be much more difficult to disconnect and connect spiritually. So we recommend the early morning. Saints are amazing. They say the richest person in the world is not the one who has the most, but the one who needs the least. Sometimes people are running around in this world, chasing and feeling as though they have the freedom to do anything and they would like. They're running around everywhere, but actually they're completely imprisoned by their own material desires, by their greed, by lust. Whereas the saints, they're just sitting in one place. But they're the ones who are actually free, because they've freed themselves from all of the demands and all of the things that bind people, their own negative qualities, the things that imprison us. They become free from all of that. And so Narottam Das Thakur was one of those great saints who had everything materially, but who turned away from it to dedicate his life in service to God, service to humanity. Narottam Das Thakur was particularly an incredible person because he actually wrote these beautiful songs. He was a songwriter. And what he managed to do in these songs is capture the essence of philosophy, but he also managed to capture the essence of the mood of a spiritualist full of love. And so he was able to combine philosophy and emotion in these songs, which one of our teachers says, if you want to develop divine love, then all you need to do is go and purchase these books and sing these songs, because these songs contain the essence of philosophy and the essence of the emotional mood of the spiritualist with divine love. So he's an incredible person. I have many ideas and I also have a busy life, and writing requires a certain amount of disconnection and just absorption. But I'm planning one book, which I hope will come out in the coming months. And that's a collection of writings and reflections that I've been writing over the past 5 years. So about 10 or 15 years ago, I began writing a blog. I never saw myself as a writer, but I thought, let me write, and that will help me to become more reflective about everything I'm going through in life. Mm-hmm. And it continued, and I continued blogging, and I continue doing it till this day. And over the last 5 years, I've written some things, you know, daily observances of the world, reflections on interactions I've had with people, conversations, commentary on the issues of the day. And so I'm going to try and compile all of this along with my own diary entries, some of my many diary entries. I've been journaling for about 20 years. And so I'm going to try and bring all of these things together and create a book which will, hopefully give people an insight into how relevant the wisdom of the ancient teachings of the Bhagavad Gita and the Vedas are in decoding the world that we live in today, and also providing solutions for a better way of living. You're getting me on camera to say this. I hope within the next 3 months, When we look at the world, there's unlimited opportunities. There's so many projects we want to launch. There's so many active contributions we want to make to the world as well, spiritual, philanthropic work. There's so many people we want to meet in this world who are who are spiritually inclined and who also have a desire to do similar things to what we're doing, and by combining forces we can take these teachings further. We're now on social media and we're reaching out. The world's like a global village and we're all connected. So there are so many opportunities opening up. It's a really, really exciting time. And we want to just do more of what we've been doing in the last 20 years. And we want to do it in a better way, in a bigger way, in a way that really reaches people's hearts. And basically what we want to teach the world is that you can't solve the problems of the world with the same type of thinking that created them. In other words, we want to share with the world that real change can only occur when wisdom is proliferated in society. Basically, we want to change the world through wisdom. And we want to share with people that if we take some time and look back at what the great sages and the saints and the scriptures of the world have shared with us, then when we look forward in terms of how we're moving and progressing in life, if we're able to incorporate that wisdom, then we can craft a more beautiful life for ourselves and craft a better and more beautiful world for future generations. I think life is about exploration. Life is about curiosity. Life is about questioning. I think we should try new things. Einstein said, never stop questioning. Curiosity has its own reason for existing. And so I would encourage anyone to explore the spiritual path, explore what more there may be to life that we didn't necessarily learn in school or university. I would encourage people to challenge the way they're thinking about what success is. I would encourage people to disconnect from everything the world told you to be and really look deep within yourself and ask what your own inner calling is. I would encourage people to look at the world and ask the bigger questions. Why am I here? Why does this world exist? What happens after this life? Why do bad things happen to good people? Why does love never seem to last? These are the questions of life that tug on each one of our minds and hearts, but the wise person takes time to really explore whether there could be answers. And so this is the great adventure of going on the spiritual path. It's a journey into the unknown, but an unknown that can bring you to a treasure house of happiness. As Swamis, there's a certain culture of respect that people have towards a monk. When we look in our own hearts, then we don't have an over-inflated conception of ourselves. When we look in the mirror, then we know that we're works in progress. We're not perfect and pure specimens of spiritual perfection. But there's a culture, and cultured people follow that culture. And so I think Rishi Sunak bowing down to me is more a reflection of his own good culture than necessarily any eminence on my part. But it's encouraging to see that we have leadership which now has some spiritual connection. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, whatever great people do, common people follow. And whatever standards they set by their exemplary acts, all the world pursues. And so we really do need spiritual leaders. We need leaders who are competent in their fields of expertise, but who also factor in spirituality, because that will help us to really create solutions which are powerful and progressive. So it was an encouraging day to see Rishi come in and spend time in the spiritual community. We had been invited, the youth, the faith leaders from the younger generation across the UK were invited to Lambeth Palace for an interfaith gathering with the Queen. And at that time, I was one of the faith leaders in the country nominated to attend that function. And so we had the great honor to meet Her Majesty the Queen and express our appreciation to her. I think the Queen, for me, she was an emblem of satisfaction. She was given a role in her life, obviously ordained by Providence to take up that role. And she was satisfied. She took that role, she took it to heart. She didn't look for a different life. She realized that this was her calling and this was her purpose. And she fully gave herself to that, such commitment. I think the Queen was an amazing person because she exuded so much sobriety in the face of being such a public figure, being so famous, so eminent in the world. She lived with complete integrity and never allowed that to overwhelm her or compromise her own character or principles for decades on end. So I think there's so much we can learn from the Queen, and it really was an honor to meet her, and I feel very fortunate. And I got a picture to as a memento and a memory. Cricket. Truth. Srila Prabhupada. Share wisdom that breathes. Essential. Powerful. Pizza. A great cricketer I was named after. Yoga. The playground of God. A spiritual warrior. The best friend. Your own heart, which has become free of material desires. The Bhagavad Gita. Changing the world through wisdom. To serve. What the heart seeks the most. That which blocks us from seeing our true self. Something that comes from service. Available through control of the mind and senses. Something that divides and destroys. The spiritual reality which is beyond the conceptions of the mind. The means of connection and union. The mother of all qualities. That which can be your best friend or your worst enemy.